evening, and welcome back to Guest Baptist Church. I hope you're enjoying your day, and I hope you enjoy tonight's service. Thank you.
Well, I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Folks, I just got to say something before I sing this song here. If you missed this morning's service, Brother John, I'm telling you what, it was an uplifting service. And if you missed it, I encourage you to go back and look at it and watch it, because it's going to really bless your heart, I promise you. I sang a song this morning, God on the Mountain. And, you know, I know sometimes we go through these valleys and stuff, but, you know, the Holy Spirit dwells inside of me, and when we're in these valleys, I still feel like I'm up on that mountain, because when he lives inside you, you know that you've got somebody that's there going to be there with you to help you through these times. So y'all just go back and look at this morning's message there. Josh asked me to sing this song right here.
I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way. It looks like you're guilty, now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor, I have no defense, but that's when mercy walked in. Oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand was God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sins, forgiven when mercy walked in. I stood there and wondered, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free? My chains were broken, I felt born again, the moment that mercy walked in. Oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand, was God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered when mercy walked in. The blood was presented that covered my sins. Forgiven when mercy walked in.
You know, y'all just got to listen to that service this morning. I was going to say something bad, but y'all just got to go back and listen to it. Don't want to spoil nothing. Y'all just go listen to it. It just blessed my heart.
This life is a journey we walk by faith. There will always be the mountains in our way. But right here in this moment, may our strength be renewed as we recall what God has done, how we've seen Him move. If there's anybody here who's found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able, say amen. And if there's anybody here who's seen His power, the fire, say amen. Oh, anybody here found joy in the middle of sorrow, just say amen. Sometimes through the darkness it's hard to see, so just be brave and follow where He leads. 'Cause greater is the one who's in us than he who's in the world. So child of God, remember, the battle is the Lord's. And if there's anybody here who's found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able, say amen. And if there's anybody here who's seen His power, anybody here brought through the fire, say amen. Anybody here found joy in the middle of sorrow, peace in the storm, hope for tomorrow? You've seen it time and time again, just say amen. Even in the valley of the shadow, when you feel alone in the unknown, say amen, say amen. Oh, even when the storms are raging, standing know you're not forsaken, just say amen, say amen. Is there anybody here? Tell me, is there anybody here? Come on and say amen. And if there's anybody here who's seen His power, anybody here brought to the fire, come on and say amen. Oh, anybody here found joy in the
middle of sorrow, peace in the storm, hope for tomorrow. You've seen it time and time again, just say amen. Just say
tonight, if you have your Bibles with you, turn with us to the book of Romans. Book of Romans, chapter 11. We're going to begin reading there tonight in verse 33. Just let me warn you, I'm probably going to do more teaching than I am preaching through this series. But if you, those of you that know me know that I can't hardly teach without preaching. So there's going to be some times that... that you're going to think, well, he's just teaching, and then I'm going to spring into preaching. But anyway, I feel like that the Lord has really laid this series on my heart. I don't know that we will just have it on Sunday night. We may have some parts will be on Sunday morning. I'm not sure as of yet. I can promise you I'm going to follow the direction that the Holy Spirit sends me in. But we're going to study through Romans chapter 12 through chapter 16. And you're probably thinking, why did you tell us to turn to chapter 11? Because I've got to lay some background information this morning. But this series of messages is a personal, practical application to a passion-filled life. Let me say that one more time. It is a personal, practical application to a passion-filled life. And tonight, as we dive into this scripture, I'm going to ask you to underline some things. I'm going to ask you to maybe use a highlighter in your Bible, because I want you to get what the Lord, I feel like, has shown me through this message. And I want you to have passion in your life as you passionately serve Jesus, and as you passionately live out the rest of your life in His will. So that being said, let's pray really fast, and then we'll get into tonight's message. Father, God, we love You. We thank You. We praise You, God, for this opportunity to get to teach Your Word. And Father, tonight I pray that You'd give me clarity of speech, clarity of mind. And Father God, give those that are home and listening tonight ears to listen and hearts to obey Your Word. And Father, I know that these are trying times, but I know You're in control, and I want to thank You for that. And God, I just pray that You'd have Your will and Your way through this message. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. So Romans chapter number 11. Verse 33 is where I feel like we need to begin. And it says, "Oh, the depths of the riches both of wisdom and knowledge of God. Oh, the depth of the riches both of the wisdom and knowledge of God." So Paul is writing here to the in the book of Romans, and he's talking about the depth and the riches. And then he goes on, and we're going to get into that. So this is everything that we're reading this morning. It's vital for you to understand where we're going as a part of a personal, practical application to live in a passion-filled life. He says, "How unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out." Now, I'm going to ask you to take a highlighter or to take a pen and underline that last phrase. His ways are past finding out. His ways are past finding out. So Paul introduces us here in this passage of Scripture, and it says the depth and the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God, are unbelievable. They're unsearchable. And his judgments are, and his ways are past finding out. In other words, he's saying it's beyond our grasp, it's beyond our intelligence in order to try to bring God down to our level. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are so much higher than ours are, as the heavens is above the earth, so it says in the book of Isaiah. So that's what Paul is trying to get across here, but I got somewhere that I want to go. In verse 34, it says, "For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Or who hath been his counselor?" He asked the question here, who's known the mind of the Lord? And then he asked another question, who has been his counselor? Who has guided God through his goodness and through his ways? The answer to that question is nobody. There's nobody been God's counselor. There's nobody that has known the mind of the Lord. It is impossible. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts not ours. How could we counsel God into doing what we think God ought to do? However, many times, many a Christian will find themselves telling God how they want God to do things. And that is not living a passion-filled life. That will lead to a life of disappointment, because you really don't want God to do things your way. Right. I've said it oftentimes that if I were in charge of the weather, that sometimes I'd like to be in charge. I'd like to make it about 80 degrees and the sun shining, and with a little 5-mile-an-hour wind blowing, and to me, that's perfectness. That's absolutely perfection. But you know that I'd mess up the weather, because God knows when we need the rain. God knows when we need the coldness to get rid of some of the life that are in some of the insects and certain things. God knows all of those things. So if I were just even in control of one part of what God's in control of, I'd mess it all up. That same scenario goes tonight with those that want to be in control of their own life. Folks will say, it's my life, and I want to do things my way, and I want to do things my own way, and it does not matter what anybody else says. Well, it matters what God says.
Amen.
Because if you were in control of your own life, listen, you'd mess it up. Just as if I were in control of the weather, I'd mess that up. If you are in control tonight of your own life, listen, you're going to mess it up. And I'm telling you tonight, there's a personal, practical word here for somebody to be able to live a passion-filled life. And I'm talking about being passionately in love with the Lord Jesus, being passionately in love with His Word, because the more you get in His Word, the less you'll find and think about what you think, because you'll be searching His words, wanting to know what He thinks.
Amen.
So it says here, who has been His counselor? Who has known the mind of the Lord? Verse 35, or who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again. He asked the question, does God owe you anything? And the answer to that question is absolutely not. God does not owe us anything. God didn't, you say, well, I didn't ask to be born. Do you understand that God gave you the gift of life? He gave you the gift of life, but listen, Jesus said, I'm not come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. So he's already given you the gift of life. He also wants to give you the gift of the abundant life, which is only known in knowing Jesus. It's the only way that you're going to find it. Or verse 36, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. All right, let's break that verse down. For of him and through him and to him are all things. That's everything that you see as you look around your room tonight, as you're watching this. Everything you see is his. I want you to maybe stand up if you're in your bedroom and look over at your dresser. More than likely, there's a mirror there. And look in that mirror, and you're going to see what is his. It is his. It says all things. All things are of him, through him, and to him. To whom be glory forever. Amen. A lot of folks will say, I just don't know why that God has allowed me to live, or maybe somebody gets through an accident or goes through a health issue, and they'll say, well, I don't know what purpose God has for me, but I know he has a purpose. I've heard it thousands of times. Maybe you've even said it yourself. Listen to me. What your purpose is to bring him glory. Amen. That's your purpose in life, is to bring him glory. That is the only reason that you were given the gift of life, is to bring him glory. To whom be glory forever. Amen. And then chapter 12, verse 1, I'm going to read these first two verses together. And then we're going to go in and we're going to dissect it. We're going to take it apart and we're going to see what it says. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. These two verses have been quoted and quoted and quoted about presenting yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. And listen, I'm sure they're applicable every time they've been quoted, and I've quoted it myself using that. But listen, you have to put this thing into context as we go through and try to look at a personal, practical application for God's Word. And listen, tonight I want you to understand that the Word of God is a personal thing. The walk that you will have with God is a personal thing. And so you have to always, as you look at a passage of Scripture, you got to say, how does that apply to me? How can I make that applicable in my life? So I'm going to give you a personal application that's going to absolutely change your life if you'll listen to what I'm telling you. It says, I beseech you, therefore. Now, we've already established that Paul wrote the book of Romans, and we talked about how Paul was explaining some things about the unsearchable riches and the knowledge and the wisdom that God has, and how nobody has ever been his counselor, how he doesn't owe anybody anything, and that you were all made for his glory, to bring him glory. And Paul immediately, and I want you to understand that when Paul wrote the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 was not there. All right? Chapter 11 and verse 36 was not there. There was no chapter endings. There were no verse numbers beside of it. Paul says what he says in verse 36 and immediately goes into the next verse and says, I beseech you, therefore. Anytime you see in Scripture a therefore, you got to ask yourself, what's it there for? What is it talking about? So you have to go back prior to the therefore and to see why it's there. And he says, I beseech you, therefore. Well, why is that therefore there? It is because that God's got unsearchable wisdom, because God's got unsearchable knowledge. It's because God does not owe us anything. It's because God created us for His glory. It's because of those things. So that's why the therefore is therefore. Paul is saying, because of all of this, I beseech you, or I beg of you, therefore. I see in this, and this is where it gets real personal, there is an invitation. It says, I beseech you, therefore, that I see here an invitation. Paul is extending an invitation as he says, I beseech you. He's saying, I beg of you, I am inviting you because of what your prior knowledge, because you understand the highness of God's ways, because you understand how great He is and how His knowledge passes human knowledge. You understand that His ways are higher than ours. You understand that you were created for His glory and for His glory alone. You understand those things, so I'm inviting you, I'm begging you to take it to the next level. There's an invitation here. But he says these words, I beseech you, therefore, brethren. See, there is a fundamental foundation that is necessary in order to be able to go into the next level. It's found right there in that word, brethren. Brethren is not talking about just men. It's talking about those that are in the family of God. And it's because we know the unsearchable riches of God's grace, of God's knowledge, of God's wisdom, Paul is inviting us to take it to the next level. I beseech you, therefore, brethren. Listen, tonight it is a fundamental, foundational thing that you must first be saved. You must first be in the kingdom of God as a child of God before you can ever take it to the next level. The reason that a whole lot of Baptist folk today don't seemingly know their purpose in life is because they've never entered in at the foundation, which is the cross of Christ. Until you realize, and you're standing there in the midst of this chapter, and you realize that at one time you were doomed and dying and damned and deserving of a devil's hell, and all of a sudden from on high He reached down and He saved your sorry soul. Until you've been to that point, you'll never get to go to the next point.
Amen.
Till you get to that point and say, you know what, I'm doomed and I was dying and I was damned and I deserve to go to hell. Until you get to that point, you'll never take it to the next point, because that's where we all really are. A lot of folks think God did, or that they did God a favor by getting saved. No. God showed favor upon you and upon your life to bring Him glory. God did those things for us. And listen to me, when you're standing in the midst of this and you realize that, man, God his knowledge is unsearchable. His wisdom is unsearchable. Nobody's ever taught God anything. God does not owe me anything, and I was created for His glory, and He saved me. He brought me up out of the miry clay. He set my feet on a solid rock. He saved my sorry, good-for-nothing soul, and He loved me so much He gave His life for me. I just cannot understand love like that. But listen, that's the invitation. invitation that Paul extends. He says, because that you've been there, because that you know where you were and you know where God brought you from, you know the highness of His glory and the unsearchable knowledge that He has, and He loved you enough to save you. I beseech you, therefore, He's inviting you, let's take this thing to the next level. How many of you tonight have ever been to the next level with God? But Paul extends the invitation. He extends the invitation here. Now, in this invitation in verse 1, he says, by the mercies of God. So if you've met the fundamental part of having the foundation of salvation, then you can move past the invitation. That invitation is for you. And it says, by the mercies of God. Do you understand tonight that only by the mercies of God do we get an invitation to know God even more?
Right. Amen.
It was only by the mercies of God that we got an invitation to know Him in the first place. You say, Brother John, I don't know what you're saying. Listen to me tonight, I want to be really, really clear about this. You don't get saved when you want to. You don't get saved when you think it's convenient for you to get saved. You don't get saved just because you think. You first have to be offered the invitation through the person of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit convicts your heart and shows you that you need to be saved. So it's only by the mercies of God that any of us are invited to know Him in the first place. And it'll be only by the mercies of God that we get to receive the invitation to know Him even deeper.
Amen.
That you present your bodies a living sacrifice. There's some something that goes along with this invitation. If you're going to know God more, you're going to have to do less with yourself.
Amen.
Because once you want to know God more, you want to please Him with the life that you live. And once you want to please Him with the life that you live, this flesh has to die. So that way the Christ that lives inside of you can do the living through you. See, that's the personal invitation. And listen to me tonight, as you're sitting there in the privacy of your own home and you're enjoying watching this on YouTube, listen, I'm telling you that this is a personal thing. Read closely that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. How much more personal can you get? See, your pastor can't do it for you. Your Sunday school teacher cannot do it for you. Kids, your mom and dad cannot do it for you. Don't matter how much they love you. It does not matter how much your Sunday school teacher loves you or your pastor loves you. And it does not matter how much the desire of those people are for you to take your relationship with God to the next level. It is on you. It's personal. Paul is begging. He when that word beseech is a beg, it's an invitation. It's because because you've been to the cross, because you understand salvation, because you understand how much He loved you and how you were created for His glory. Paul is saying, I beg of you, brethren, by the mercies of God, utilize the invitation, because it was by the mercies of God that you were offered this invitation to know God even deeper. And it says that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. I guess in all of the Bible, John the Baptist illustrates this point the very best. John the Baptist said, for Christ to increase, then I must decrease. Listen, for you in your life, for Christ to increase, then you must decrease. That is presenting your body as a living sacrifice.
Amen.
Do you know tonight that as we preach this, and I promise you, I believe that holy living is right kind of living. I believe that God has a standard. But listen, I am not a legalist. I don't think that we do stuff in order to find favor with God. However, I do believe that we find favor with God whenever we live up to His standard. And so therefore, that is presenting your body a living sacrifice. Listen, what it means for me is that I don't want people to see John Mays. I don't want people to hear John Mays. I want people to hear Jesus Christ when I speak. I want people to see Jesus Christ when I walk by them, by my actions, by the things that I do. And y'all, it's like we said, it's easy to do that on Sunday, but it's real hard to do that on Monday. When we get around a different group of people, when we're not surrounded by brothers and sisters in Christ, y'all, that's when the rubber meets the road. That's when it just becomes real. And it's whether or not that you have that real relationship with God that He wants you to have, that He desires you to have, that He's giving you the invitation for, it's up to you whether or not you have that.
Right.
Whether or not you take it to the next level. A lot of folks don't want to take it to the next level because people will think that they're some kind of fanatic. I'm going to tell you something tonight. I don't give a flip what people think. I care what he thinks.
Amen.
And I care tonight about my relationship with the Lord. And y'all, I'm going to tell you this from the heart of a pastor. I care about your relationship with God and about where it's at. And I'm telling you tonight that if you have been to the cross, if you have laid the fundamental foundation of salvation and He has saved you, that this invitation is for you, that you present your body a living sacrifice. Paul is inviting you, or really the Holy Spirit is inviting you through the inspired words of Paul to a deeper knowledge and a deeper relationship with God. A living sacrifice. And then there's a comma there. It says holy, righteous living. Acceptable unto God. Y'all, listen. One of these days, we're going to stand before a holy God at the Bema seat, at the judgment seat of Christ. And that is for all of those that have been to the cross, all of those that have been saved. And the Bema seat is where we will receive rewards for how our life has been lived ever since we've known Jesus. It will be with how many folk we have told about the Word of God, how we have fulfilled our Great Commission. And I'm going to tell you, I will stand before God and other men of God will stand before God with their callings on their life. The Bible teaches us that the callings of God are without repentance. You cannot get out of them. You can't get away from them. And I will stand before a holy God at the Bema seat one day with every idle word that has ever proceeded out of my mouth. And you will too if you know Him as your Lord and Savior. And you don't have to worry about losing your salvation. What you do have to worry about is a loss of reward.
Amen.
But the Bible says, holy and acceptable unto God. Every time that I stand and preach God's word, I'm going to have to give an account for that. And I cannot shake it. It's a personal conviction of mine. I want to be prepared. I want to be studied up. I want to be prayed up. Any time that I stand behind this pulpit or behind any other pulpit, because I know one day I'm going to give an account to a holy and a mighty God. And He has called me to do something, but He's called me to be His mouthpiece, not to preach my opinion, but to preach the book. And I'm telling you, that's the only thing that will be acceptable unto God. I remember one time, very first revival I got to preach. They had let me know or had asked me to preach this revival about 3 or 4 weeks ahead of time, before the revival was to start. So I had 3 or 4 weeks to prepare myself, to get my messages prepared, and to pray and to do all of those things. And I felt like going into the week on a Sunday night. Going into the week, I felt like, man, I've got all 6 messages lined up that God wants me to preach. I knew what day He wanted me to preach them on. I felt like, I had me a list, and I had my notes for each night, and it was going to be good. I was excited. I couldn't wait to get to preach, and never had got to preach 6 nights in a row, so I was really looking forward to it, and I couldn't wait. But y'all, I'll never forget Wednesday night of that week. I'm 4 nights in to a week-long revival, and Wednesday night of that week, we were sitting there in the church house, and they were singing, and I was sitting on the front row waiting on the singing to get done, and God spoke to me. This was the first time that God ever did this exact thing in my life. It scared me to death. He spoke and He said, "You're not preaching what you think you're preaching." And I'm just going to be honest with you. I sat on the front row of that church and I said, "Oh, yes, I am. I don't have no other notes, God. And I'm young. I don't know how to just pull a message out of thin. I don't know. God, you're just gonna have to. You're messing with me now." I was like, "God, you're messing with me." God said, "You're not preaching that." And I said, "Oh yes, I am." About that time, the singers got done. They invited me up to preach. And I got up there in that pulpit and I read the scripture that I had went into the week thinking that I was going to preach on Wednesday night. I went into that and I read that scripture and I got down to pray. And any of you that's ever heard me preach know that almost every time that I preach, I'll bow behind the pulpit and I will ask God to make me His mouthpiece. And that night, it was no different. I got down and I prayed and I said, "God, would You make me Your mouthpiece in this place?" And I'm talking about instantly, before I even got the words completely out of my mouth, the Lord spoke again and said, "You don't want to be my mouthpiece. You want to preach your message, so you do it on your own." And my wife was there, my kids were there, the older ones, and they can be a testimony to this. I stood back to my feet mid-prayer, and I said, "Y'all gonna have to forgive me and sing me one more song. Lord's changed my message, and I want to be what He wants me to be." And that night, I'm going to tell you something. I had one song to prepare. But I promise you, I wished I had a recording, because I think it was the best message I ever preached. Do you know why? Wasn't none of it about me.
Amen. Amen.
I didn't. God, I'm telling you, God sat down on me and literally made me his mouthpiece.
Amen.
It had nothing to do with me. That is what is acceptable unto God. That's what is acceptable unto God, because a lot of times we think this Christian walk is about us. It's not. It's about him. It's about bringing him glory. That's what's acceptable. And in the Bible, it gives us a comma here, which is a little pause. And it's a change of thought. He says, present your bodies a holy sacrifice, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, let me ask you this question. As we're studying our way through this, why would Paul, the Holy Spirit, through the person of Paul, issue an invitation of what you're supposed to be doing already? It says it's your reasonable service. But Paul's already issued the invitation. So why is Paul issuing an invitation for something that we're supposed to be doing already? Same reason that we're issuing this invitation tonight. Because God wants you at a deeper level.
Amen.
God wants you at a higher plane of knowing who he is, and of knowing his word, and of knowing which way your life needs to go and which direction you need to take. And the Bible says those you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. He is not asking us to be unreasonable. Yet a lot of Baptists will say, well, I'm giving God Sunday morning, or I'm giving God Sunday night. Why would I want to give God a Wednesday night? Or why would I want to give God my daily time of my TV time and turn it into a time of devotion? Because it's your reasonable service. Because God wants you at a deeper level. Because God's inviting you, saying, please come in here. See, I see this as Paul was pinning down these words here in the book of Romans. I see it like this. Paul was saying, God is awesome. God is holy. God is glorious. God, nobody owe God anything. Nobody's ever taught God anything. And I see it like this. Come on in. Don't you want to know him better? That's the invitation. But see, there's something that goes with the invitation. There's some intention. Do you know that you'll never know God on a deeper level without you intending to? God is not going to force himself on you. God is not going to sit down in your bedroom and make you, slap you over the head and make you open up your Bible. There's got to be some intention on your part.
Amen.
There, you have to be intentional whenever you open up the Bible and begin to read it. You've got to intend. And you say, Brother John, how do you do that? Here's how you do that. You sit down and you pray before you open up the book. You don't just open up the book and point your finger down there with your eyes closed and say, this verse is for me. No, God will, you take that and God will use that sometimes. But let me tell you, whenever you're being intentional, you're really getting into the book. And you know what? The Lord's sitting down right beside of you saying, have you seen this before? Can I show you just a little bit more? You ever read something in the Bible that you've read 100 times and you never saw it? You've just skimmed through and you just read over. But then the Holy Spirit comes in and shines a little new light on it. Something you'd never seen before. And you think, my goodness, was that there the whole time? Yes. But that's what makes it the living Word of God, is that the author is sitting down beside of you whenever you're wanting to know more about Him, and He's revealing more about Himself. That's what we should be doing already, but there's got to be some intention about it. And then you come to the second verse here, and here becomes the practical. We've already covered the personal. We've already covered the personal, but now we're going to cover the practical. Of how do I do this, Brother John? How do I get to that second level or to that next level with God? It says, be not conformed to this world. Be not conformed to this world. Do not let this world define you. Do not let the things of this world shape you. Let the Word of God shape you. Let the Holy God that sits in heaven shape your life. Let Him be in your thoughts. Let Him be in your life on a daily basis. Be not conformed to this world. Don't let this world define who you are. It says, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Brother John, how do I renew your mind? You get in this book.
Amen.
You get in this book and you say, set down the things of this world, and you say, I'm not worried about what some Super Bowl champion has to say about God. I'm worried about what God has to say about me and about my life. That's what it basically boils down to. People will quote famous people about their sayings of God, but what does God say about you?
Amen.
That's what matters. That's being transformed by the renewing of your mind. Your mind is not on things on this earth, but they're on things in heaven. And where your mind is, there your heart will be also, because where your riches is, there your heart is. And let me tell you something. I don't have a whole lot on this side, probably never have a whole lot on this side, but I'm going to walk on streets of gold. I'm telling you, I've got a mansion that your mind cannot believe, that Jesus went to prepare for me. One of these days, I'm going to wear some crowns and I'm going to cast them down at Jesus' feet. I'm telling you, that is being transformed by the renewing of your mind, because you're setting your mind on things above, not on things below.
Amen.
That you may prove, and I know I've been long and I'm going to hurry right here. It says that you may prove. Again, notice it's personal. That you may prove. What is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God? I want you to take your highlighter or your pen, and I want you to underline those words right there. What is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God? And y'all wait just a second with me, because I promise I'm getting somewhere. Did not chapter 11, verse 33, I had you underline something over there. The Bible says His ways are past finding out. Yet in chapter 12, verse 2, it says that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Is the Bible contradicting itself here? No, absolutely not. His ways are past finding out until you accept the invitation and you begin to be intentional about going to the next level with God. And then He said you're going to have some knowledge that you didn't have before. You're going to have some understanding that otherwise you're not going to understand, or otherwise you're not going to get. And it says that you can prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. See, the invitation is by intention only. You have to be intentional. You listen, the invitation has went out. What do you intend to do with it? But the last thing that I want to say tonight is that it leads to an invitation.
where you'll actually know the mind of God. Where you'll be able to know what is that good and acceptable and perfect will. Because you got to know Him. You know, I used the illustration a week or two ago, I don't know when, about when me and my wife were dating. We would talk on the phone. We'd spend every waking hour that we wasn't at work together. And it was because I wanted to know her. I wanted to know everything there was to know. I wanted to know her favorite color. I wanted to know how her day had been. I wanted to know what her favorite foods were. I wanted to know everything that there was to know about my bride because I loved her that much. How long has it been since we loved God that much? When we wanted to be intimate with God and have an intimate knowledge of who He is and of what His will is for our lives. Y'all, I know that this has been long, and I hope I hadn't chased too many rabbits. But I'm going to tell you something tonight. As the Holy Spirit has pushed me in this direction, I believe He's offering an invitation to somebody that's listening. He's offering an invitation that you've got to be intentional about knowing Him. And then He's offering intimacy with you. And He's wanting to give you knowledge that you've never had before. He's wanting to show you things in His Word that you've never seen before. He wants to know you. And I love you. And I'm going to pray with you real quick and we're going to go. Lord, I love you. And I thank you for tonight's message. I thank you for the words that you've located in your word for us to know who you are and to know you better and to know you in an intimate way. And Father, you've issued that invitation to each of us. And God, I pray that we'll have some folks that will be intentional about getting to know you, that will be intentional about their walk with you. Father, I pray by the time that COVID-19 is over and we return to the houses of worship that we'll see Christians that know you more and know you better than they did when this started. God, I pray that you'd give them the hunger, the desire to know you. I want to thank you, Lord, for the walk that I've had with you. And I want to thank you, Lord, for what you show me. And I ask you, God, to continue to show yourself to me. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.